Okay, if you would, open your Bible tonight to John chapter 3. Here on Sunday night, the title of our lessons is called, Be Not Deceived. Jesus, throughout his earthly ministry, as recorded in Matthew, Mark, and John, warned us constantly about deception. And then the epistles of the apostles, when you read Paul's epistles, many, many places he warns us about deception. And then you read Hebrews through Revelation, especially books like Jude. The whole book of Jude is a warning about false teachers and false prophets who deceive. Second Peter, that whole book is almost dedicated to the subject of deception and who deceives and how they deceive, and we're warned not to be deceived. So it's obvious for me that throughout the New Testament, Christians need to be warned about deception. And there's a lot of deception today. And if you don't think it is, just talk to the normal Christian today and see how deceived they really are about a number of different issues. Now, in these studies about deception, all the things that we are warned about being deceived by, as you know, begin with the letter S. Number one is salvation. Be not deceived about salvation. Now, if you're saved, you're not deceived about salvation. If you were deceived about salvation, you would not be saved. But the lost world out there is greatly deceived about that issue. And the biggest problem they have is in this idea that God saves those who do enough good works. They believe in their heart that if their good works outweigh the bad, in the end, God will save them and take them to heaven. That lie is believed not only in this country, not only in Europe or Asia, but throughout the whole world. You know, Brother Julian Vipan, one of our missionaries, went to Central Asia a few months ago, and the same issues that we deal with right here in Coden, Alabama, way down here in L.A., lower Alabama, the same issues over there. Salvation by works, security. A lot of people over there come from a background of the Russian Orthodox Church. And that church teaches works for salvation. It's very much like the Catholic Church. And it's just as hard there as it is here to convince people that salvation is free. They just cannot accept that fact in their minds. And then the other deception they have is that salvation is not secure. Just over there, just like here, finding someone today that believes in security, they're hard to find. Most folks don't believe it, most lost people. So we're told not to be deceived about salvation. And you wonder why anyone could be, because the Bible, especially Paul's epistles, deals with those issues page after page. And then we're told not to be deceived about service. People have this idea, here's where Christians are deceived. They are deceived about service. They assume that because salvation is free, everything's free. But it's not. There are certain things, certain blessings, promises, rewards, crowns that are conditional upon the works we do in this life. And if we do the works, we'll receive the crowns, blessings, and reward. And if we don't do the works, we'll suffer the loss of those crowns and blessings and rewards. Now, you never suffer the loss of salvation, but you can certainly suffer the loss of rewards. So that's something don't be deceived by. And then the last time, we talked about the issue of suffering. Many folks have this idea that God will reward all suffering, but that is not true. That's a lot of suffering we bring on ourselves, being chastised for sins. That suffering there is not going to gain anybody a reward. So God does not reward all suffering. The Bible makes it clear that the suffering that God will reward at the judgment is suffering we do for Christ's sake in this life. Any kind of sacrifice you make for Christ in this life will not go ignored by God of Christ. He will bring it up in judgment, and he will reward any sacrifice you make for him in your life, any suffering you endure. And you can suffer right here in America, just like they are in Asia today or in the Middle East. Now, in the Middle East, Asia, most of the suffering is physical. But right here in America, you can suffer spiritual and mental suffering. And we read a number of verses last week, if you remember, in Matthew and Luke, where Jesus said that in the last days, or even right now, that men will hate you, they'll separate you from their company, they'll slander you, talk evil about you. Well, that's not physical suffering, but yet it's still suffering. The Lord called it persecution. And he said, when that happens to you, he said, rejoice and leap for joy, for great is your reward in heaven. So a Christian can indeed suffer right here in America. Now, tonight, the letter S stands for what I call, well, what the Bible calls, the second birth. And of course, I'm talking about the new birth. In John chapter 3, we'll begin reading in verse 1. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these things, miracles, that thou doest except God be with him. Jesus answered and said to him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Nicodemus is typical of lost people. Whenever God talks about spiritual things, they think physical. When Jesus talks about being born again, Nicodemus automatically thinks of childbirth, physical childbirth. Verse 5, Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the water, Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. Now, in verse 3, Jesus said, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. In verse 5 and 6, he said, Except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Now, there are many people today, especially religious people, sitting in churches, who are deceived about the water. They're deceived about the water in John 3, 5. The Lord talks about being born of water. And they assume it has to be water baptism. And they assume that you must be baptized in water to be born again. Now, is that true? And the answer, of course, is no. As a matter of fact, you'll notice in these verses we just read, he spoke about being born of water, born of the flesh, and born of the Spirit. You see that? It appears as if there are three births in these verses. But what's the answer? Well, the answer is two of those births are the same. To be born of the flesh is the same as being born of water, because every physical birth is a water birth. You know, a child in the mother's womb is encased in a sack of water, a water sack. They had a film clip here recently of a child, and I don't know how this happened, but that child was delivered from his mother's womb still encased in that water sack. And the child was stillborn, I guess. But it was just like, I tell you what it was like. You know the water jug we have here in the back that has the water in it? That child was delivered in a sack of water. He was dead, he was stillborn, but he was inside of this water. The most amazing thing. So every physical birth is a water birth. Women know that. Doctors know that. So really there are only two births in the verses. Physical, spiritual. And unless you're born the second time by the Spirit, you cannot enter into the kingdom of God. So we should not be deceived about water baptism. Water baptism has nothing to do with the new birth. To be born of water is to be born the first time physically. To be born of the Spirit is to be born again the second time spiritually. If a person is born of water only, they will not enter into the kingdom of God. You must be born twice to get into the kingdom of God. The new birth is a spiritual birth. Matter of fact, it's your spirit, spelled with a little S, in verse 5 and 6, being born or begotten of God's Spirit, capital S, in verse 6. See, the word Spirit appears twice, right there in verse 6, little S, capital S. That little S, that's your spirit. The capital S is God's Spirit. What is the new birth? It's your spirit being born of God's Spirit. That's the new birth. Now, the new birth is also called by other names in the Bible. Go over to Titus chapter 3. You know, many doctrines in the Bible have more than one name. And each name describes a different characteristic about that doctrine. You know, you look at the word gospel. You know, there's just one saving gospel. But it's called the gospel of grace, the gospel of Christ, the gospel of the uncircumcision, the gospel of peace. The one gospel, the saving gospel, has many names. But it's still the same gospel. And the new birth has more than one name. But it's still the same new birth. And here in Titus chapter 3, in verse 5, Paul wrote, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. In that verse right there, the new birth is called regeneration. Regeneration. And that regeneration is performed by the Holy Spirit of God. And then look over to Ephesians chapter 2. It has another name over here. Ephesians chapter 2, in verse 1, Ephesians 2, 1, he said here, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. Look at verse 5. Even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. Well, the quickening of the Spirit is the new birth. And that's what the new birth is. It's when your spirit is quickened. And the word quickened means to be made alive. The new birth is when your spirit is quickened, made alive by the Holy Spirit. So it has more than one name. Just one new birth, but it has many names. It's a spiritual birth. It's when your dead spirit is quickened, made alive by God's Spirit. Now, there are those who say that being born again is not a spiritual birth, but rather they say the new birth is the resurrection of the body. See, people are not only deceived about the water in the new birth, they not only assume the water has to do with water baptism, and it doesn't, but there are others, especially the cults, who teach the new birth is not spiritual at all, but it's the resurrection of the physical body from the dead. That's what they believe the new birth is. Now, of course, every heresy today is based upon some verse of Scripture misinterpreted. And this one is. Look, if you would, to Acts 13. Acts 13, Paul is in Antioch here in the synagogue preaching. And he's preaching, of course, about Jesus Christ. And verse 26, Paul wrote, "Many brethren, children of the stock of Abraham, and whosoever among you feareth God, to you is the word of this salvation sent. But they that dwell at Jerusalem and their rulers, because they knew not him, nor yet the voices of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath day, that fulfill them in condemning him," Christ. "And though they found no cause of death in him, yet desired they that Pilate, that he should be slain. And when they had fulfilled all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a sepulcher. But God raised him from the dead. And he was seen many days of them which came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses unto the people. And we declare unto you glad tidings, how that the promise which was made unto the fathers, God hath fulfilled the same unto us, their children, and that he hath raised up Jesus again, as is also written in the second Psalm, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee. And as concerned that he raised him up from the dead, now no more to return to corruption, he said, On this wise I will give you the sure mercies of David." Now, you notice here in verse 33 and 34, that when God raised Jesus from the dead, it said, Thou art my Son, this day, when he was resurrected, this day have I begotten thee. Now here, when Christ was raised from the dead, he was begotten from the dead. See, Christ was born the first time physically in the world, but then later on, he's born again from the dead. Matter of fact, in Colossians 1:18, where we were at this morning, Jesus is called the firstborn from the dead. Now, the new birth is not the physical resurrection of our bodies from the dead. Now, these verses in Acts 13 do have a spiritual application to the new birth in John 3. For example, as Christ's body was dead, our spirit was dead. Dead in trespass and sins. As Christ's body was raised from the dead physically by God's Spirit, our dead spirit was raised from the dead, quickened, regenerated, and made alive by God. But even though there is a spiritual application here to the new birth, that is not the correct interpretation. The new birth is not physical resurrection of your physical body. Jesus said that which is born of the Spirit, capital S, is spirit, not body, not flesh, spirit. It's your spirit that's born again, not your body. And so we know then that the new birth is not the resurrection of the physical body. And one reason we know that is not only because of what Jesus said in John 3, but by the simple fact that the apostles wrote their epistles to people who were alive and had never died, and yet they were all born again. Look, if you would, to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. First Peter chapter 1, 3, he said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Look at verse 23. He said, "Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever." Peter was writing to people who were born again. And so did Brother James. Go back one book to your left. And James chapter 1, in verse 18. James 1:18. "Of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures." Begat he us with the word of truth. James wrote to people who were born again. And then look at John, 1 John chapter 5. First John chapter 5, verse 1. "Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. And everyone that loveth him that begat loveth him also that is begotten of him." John wrote to people who were born again. And so did Paul. Go back to, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. First Corinthians chapter 4, 15. He said, "For though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have you not many fathers, for in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel." These people were begotten again, through the gospel. Now, we just read where James said they were begotten by the word of truth. Paul says they're begotten by the gospel. So when Paul preached the gospel to the Corinthians, they believed it and were begotten again, born again spiritually. And then notice Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4, 28. Galatians 4, 28, Paul wrote, "Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise." When Paul said that, he's saying in effect that we are a part of the children that God promised Abraham. You know, God told Abraham, "Your seed will be as the stars of heaven for number." Well, all believers, no matter who you are, you're part of that. You're part of that seed, those children. We're children of promise. We are the children God promised Abraham. "But as then, time passed, he that was born after the flesh," that's Ishmael, "persecuted him that was born after the spirit," that's Isaac. Ishmael persecuted Isaac. "Even so it is now," present tense. So in other words, the people that Paul wrote to were born of the Spirit, and they were being persecuted by those born of the flesh only. And the ones that were born after the flesh in Galatians were the Pharisees. They were not born twice, just once. And they were persecuting those born of the Spirit. But nevertheless, Paul wrote to people who were born again by the Spirit. Now, Peter, James, John, Paul, they were not writing to dead people. They wrote to saints who were alive at the time of their writing, and they were all born again, proven beyond a doubt that the new birth is spiritual and not physical. These people didn't die and were resurrected. No, they never died. But they were all born again, showing you again the new birth is a spiritual birth, not physical. It's when your spirit is quickened, made alive by God's Spirit. Now let's talk about the necessity of the new birth for a moment. Now back there in John 3, Jesus said, ye must be born again. It's not an option. You must be born again. Now, why is that? Well, when you were born the first time, you received from your earthly parents three things. You received their life, which was temporal life, their spirit, which was dead, and their nature, which was corrupt. Three things. Their life, temporal. Their nature, corrupt. And their spirit that was dead, their life, temporal. Now, why was that true of your parents? Because it was true of their parents all the way back to Adam. Goes back to Adam. The reason why you're born with a dead spirit and a corrupt nature is because of Adam's sin. Romans 5:12, it says, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, but that all have sinned. Now, we know that when God Almighty placed Adam in the garden, he gave him a lot of freedom and just one commandment. Go back and look at it in Genesis chapter 2.
Born dead, born corrupt.
And here's the reason right here. Genesis chapter 2. And look at verse 16. In 2:16 it says, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Now Adam had freedom to eat of all the trees of the garden except one. And it's called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And God warned them. He says, in the day, you eat of this tree, they would surely die. Surely die. Now, of course, as soon as God gave Adam that one commandment, not to eat of that one single tree, along came the devil to tempt them to do what God told them not to do. And when the devil showed up in the garden, first thing he did right off the bat was to tempt Adam and Eve to eat of that one tree that God said not to eat of. Now, in chapter 3, in verse 2 and 3, it says, and the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And notice what the devil said to her. Verse 4. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as God, knowing good and evil. You know what the devil is doing there? He accused God of lying to Adam and Eve. He accused God of lying. And he told them that he said, the real reason that God does not want you to eat of that tree is because if you do, you're going to gain superior wisdom and knowledge as the gods. And those gods were probably angels who occupied the garden with them. And I know there were cherubims down there in the garden. So he's saying, God don't want you to eat that tree because if you do, you become smart and wise and have knowledge like the angels and the cherubims around you. Well, they bought into the lie, ate of the tree, and they died that day. They didn't die physically, did they?
Spiritually.
Right. We know he didn't die physically because if you trace Adam's genealogy, he lived over 900 years. They died spiritually. Their spirit died within them, and you can see how that the spirit died within them when God came to the garden to see them after they sinned. In other words, prior to the entrance of sin into the world, they had very close relationship, fellowship with God. They sought his fellowship. But after sin came, God came down to the garden. What do? They hid. They ran from God. When God got near, they ran from him. What happened? Their spirit died. And their nature became corrupt, and later on, their body died. And the point is, that physical and moral and spiritual condition of Adam and Eve was passed down to all their children, including us. When you were born the first time, you were born with a dead spirit, a corrupt nature, and temporal life. That's why we must be born again. Because when you're born again, you receive from your heavenly Father his life, which is eternal, his spirit, which is holy, and his nature, which is divine. And that makes you fit to live with God in the coming kingdom of God. That's why you must be born again. And until you do, you're not fit. You'll be just like Adam was after he sinned against God and was kicked out of the garden. Kicked out and was not allowed to go back in, was he? Matter of fact, God set up a cherubim there to keep the way into the garden so they could not get back in. Look at, if you would, verse 23 of chapter 3. Therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which kept every way to keep the way of the tree of life. Cast out of God's presence, out of God's favor, out of God's grace. He became alienated from God. And his condition was passed down to all his descendants. That's why you must be born again. Say it again.
You said their body died, their physical body died.
Not here, later on.
Later on.
Yeah, but the point is, they would have never died physically had they not sinned against God. All they had to do was eat of that tree. All they had to do, not eat of that tree, but obey God and eat of the tree of life. Two trees in the garden. One was life, one was death. And they ate the wrong one. But the whole point is this, in John 3. Don't be deceived about the water in John chapter 3. Being born of water in John 3 is not water baptism. It's the same as being born to the flesh. Being born of water, that is of the flesh, that won't get you into God's kingdom. Nicodemus thought it would because he was a Jew. He was Abraham's seed. He thought that physical birth as a physical Jew who could trace his genealogy to Abraham, he thought that was his ticket to heaven. The Jews of today believe the same thing. And that's why the Lord said to him, you got to be born again. That first birth ain't going to get you. Get it? I don't care if you are Abraham's children. You got to be born twice, this time by the Spirit of God. And it has nothing to do with water. And you say, well, I know you wouldn't say this, but maybe somebody watching this will say, well, how is a person born again? Well, evidently God knew someone would ask that question, because right there in John chapter 3, where Jesus describes the new birth, he tells you how to be born again. Because if you keep reading John 3, here's what you find out. In verse 13, John 3:13, and no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And we know that that's a reference to Christ's death on the cross. He was lifted up on the cross, dying for our sins. That Why was he lifted up? That whosoever believeth in him, believe that he was lifted up for them, should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. If you want everlasting life, if you want to be born again, here's how. Believe that when Jesus was lifted up, and he was on the cross, he was lifted up for you, for your sins, your transgressions. Believe that. Believe that alone. God will save you, give you eternal life, and your spirit will become quickened, regenerated, born again by God's Spirit. So right here in chapter 3, where Jesus described the new birth, the best description of it in the Bible, by the way, he tells you how to be born again. Because you must be born again to enter into God's kingdom.